So, this is my sixth and last talk here. Well, I'm gonna do the about me because, well, this is being recorded, so please for that. Otherwise, I think you all know me and have seen me more than you probably want to. But my name is Jos Sportvliet. I live in Berlin with my wife, Camilla, who was here but left earlier today, and Popcorn, our awesome dog. I work for OwnCloud as community manager, but I used to be a community manager for OpenSUSE at SUSE. And this presentation is about building a local community. It's very much about local meetups and things like that. So with local community, I'm mostly talking about in the city or an area in general. It's very much based on a lot of feedback and input I got from people basically, well, everywhere. But more input is absolutely welcome. I would really love it if you know, you people have something to add to this. A lot of people have, of course, valuable experience with this, and yeah, it's always great to make this better and more useful. So doing a community building effort locally has a really big advantage over building a global community, which is you can actually meet in person, face to face. And that is, I think, by far the coolest thing ever. I mean, hey, we're here at the OpenSUSE conference, and one of the things that's cool is you can actually see each other and, you know, do group hugs and group photos and group parties and dinners and all these nice things face to face, which is a lot more fun and also a very effective thing, right? I mean, face to face communication is a lot more effective than IRC, at least for a lot of issues, it's even the only way. But of course, if you want to organize local meetings, you need to have some kind of idea of what to do at these meetings, how to organize these meetings, et cetera, et cetera. So, if you want to do that, if you're interested in building a local community about OpenSUSE or OwnCloud or anything else, I hope that this talk will be helpful for you. OpenSUSE specific, as a distribution, of course, we have a nice advantage when it comes to local meetings. One of the things you need to do is to get content. Well, as distribution, you ship pretty much anything. You know, there's MySQL, so you can get somebody to talk about MySQL. There's GNOME, you can get someone to talk about GNOME. There is, you know, the Linux kernel, Python, Ruby. There's lots of different things you can talk about and discuss. At the same time, of course, it also has a bit of a downside. The people who come to a GNOME talk will most certainly not be the same people who come to a Python talk. So it's a bit harder to build up a community. So you should definitely do regular things that are, well, OpenSUSE specific. In any case, let's talk about focus, because that's, of course, what I'm talking about. You need to make some choices there. So your project really should be on the agenda, at least, I don't know, every other meeting, or maybe at the beginning of a meeting, you first spent 5, 10, 15 minutes going over the latest, you know, news and gossip from the OpenSUSE project or the OwnCloud or, again, $ project, what that you want to talk about. On the other hand, it is good to be open, to have people, even from other distributions there sometimes, to give a talk, have people from other projects involved. I mean, this brings in not just, you know, new ideas, new excitement for your own local team, but also by having people from other community, that simply attracts people outside of your own group, right? And if you want to have a nice, successful, local, fun meeting, it's, well, more people, the merrier, as they say. Another aspect of focus is that it's good to have a clear goal, to really have an idea of what your local meetup is about, especially if there are other meetups that might not be relevant if you live in a small village, but it is if you live in a big city like Berlin, New York, Boston. You know, in cities like that, there are a lot of meetups. There might be a Python community meetup every month. There might be a Ruby on Rails girls meetup thing every month. Now, you can't, well, to compete with them, to some extent you do, or at least to add to them, you need to have something that's different about your meeting, obviously. So you need to have a kind of, you know, a short mission statement, maybe, you know, like in these meetings we share knowledge of and promote Project X in weekly meetings or biweekly or monthly. So you have a real idea of what it is about. And well, more specific is better, obviously. I mean, this is very generic. Second part, when you want to set up local meetings, is, well, to get started with that. And, you know, in the beginning, that's going to be small, and really, that's okay. If you have 5 to 7 people show up, half of which are co-workers and the other half family, well, fine, you got to start somewhere, and this is okay. Yeah, start with that, right? Find a venue. I mean, if you can do it at an office at work or at a little room at the university, that's usually a good place. You should try not to spend money on it, because honestly, if you start, you can always keep spending it. It's easiest if you can get a public place. Even public libraries, I mean, there are often local community centers that are happy to host a meeting about a subject, even if they don't understand it. That's really cool. In terms of time, it depends a bit on where you live. In some places, you shouldn't do a meeting like this, you know, after 8. In other places, you really should do it before 8. So this might be something. I mean, you can look at what other communities do around you. If there are, like, again, the local Pythonistas might have a monthly meeting or something like that. Check out, see what they do. If it works for them at 8 o'clock, it's likely that it'll work for you too, as long as you don't do it on the same day. You know, then you're really competing for attention. But experiment with it, right? I mean, you can also just start at 6, and if you notice everybody says, well, I could just make it, can you do it later, then do so. Right? Just be flexible with that. It's nice to have, like, a little bit of, you know, coffee, tea, and maybe even cake, but it's not a huge deal, and I wouldn't go for full catering for sure, if only for the money. But obviously, you know, if it's fun and people are interested, you can say, hey, how about you order pizza and you just let everybody put in something and, you know, order pizza. That's cool. If you want to do a little more like than coffee and tea, then you might need a little sponsoring, but I'll get to that later. Now, of course, a big deal is getting people there, right? I mean, that's why you do it. So the thing you need to know about people is that what attracts them is the content. That's why, of course, I already said you need to focus, you need to have something interesting, right? You need to maybe have interesting speakers or something like that. And it doesn't have to be big in the beginning. You can talk yourself or get, you know, colleagues to talk about stuff. But it's content that's going to attract people in the beginning. People come for things that interest them. Talking about privacy in this NSA time is always interesting, so that'll attract people. And I would really also let this come from yourself. And the things that interest you should really be high on the agenda, if only to motivate you to organize these meetings. So pick interesting people around you, either colleagues or people you know from a little further away, and let them give talks, have a discussion, something like that, about things. That's a good start. So in general, you know, you may need to make sure that what you're doing there is interesting. Yeah. Now, there are many parts to doing something interesting, but one of them is obviously to have a kind of decent quality speaker. Now, there's a lot more to a speaker than his or her personality, and just doing something interesting is really important for a speaker. If they do something interesting, that really carries 90% of the message. But it obviously also helps if they have a little bit of experience presenting and if they have decent slides. Now, obviously, you can't change these things all that easy, but certainly the slide thing you can help with. There are lots of tips on the internet and even in my videos and on my other talks about how to make a decent presentation. And it's really worth trying to get in contact with a potential speaker before. If they don't live in the same city, do it over a hangout. If they live close by, look them up. Maybe invite them for food in a pub or something. And go over their slides. Seriously. Just make sure that you really kind of know already what's coming. And you can give some feedback. Okay, this will make them feel a little more certain about what they're going to do. Because then it fits with what you want. And you have a much better idea about them. Yeah, so really think about that, you know, get people and talk to them. It also helps to find out, of course, the right person. I already said it helps if they know what they're talking about. Especially if you want to do, you know, really technical meetings, try to get a technical person, not a journalist or a blogger, you know, try to get a developer. Obviously, they might be less good at speaking, but they do know what they're talking about, and that is a big plus. So getting people really from the project that you want to discuss is a big help, as opposed to getting someone who merely writes about the subject. But it's not a black and white thing. I mean, it helps if you have a local tech writer or a local tech journalist, of course. They can know a lot about subjects, and they usually are better at presenting it. So, you know, there's a bit of a balance there that you need to find. And keep a good relationship with speakers, because you might want to invite them again. So, you know, keep in contact, right? And give them feedback afterwards. A lot of speakers really appreciate it if you can tell them the same day or later how they did and what the people thought about it. I mean, that gives them feedback they can use to improve their, you know, presentation or their subject as well. Now, after you have picked a good subject and found something good to talk about, and find a good speaker about that subject and helped him or her get good slides together, etc., etc., at the place itself, you need to make sure, of course, that people feel welcome. There are a lot of ways to do that, but I have a few tips there. Especially in small groups, it might be nice to present new visitors shortly to the group. But please check if they like that, because obviously not all people are very comfortable standing in front of a group of people and either being talked about or talking themselves. So you should absolutely make sure that if there's a new person, you go to them and you talk to them. Just introduce yourself, say, hi, you know, I'm this and this, I organize this meeting. Would you be okay to present yourself? Not mandatory, just an idea, but if you want, you know, most of us know each other, so, you know, then you can join the gang. If they don't want to, that's cool, that's fine. Just, you know, let them lurk. I mean, that's cool. Once your group is growing, it's actually a good idea to try and find a volunteer to basically welcome people. Make sure that, you know, everyone at the meeting is being talked to. Obviously, not everybody likes to be, you know, with the role of welcoming people, but having someone who feels it as his or her responsibility, that everybody feels welcome and is being welcomed and is, you know, in contact with other people, is really good. And it's a really simple thing, right? It's not hard. And, you know, again, depending on where you live, you know, you shouldn't do this in Germany, but it can actually, it works in Asia and South America pretty well. Call them, I don't know, director of communications. You know, make it really like that's their role, give it a title and make it official. That's the person who takes care of this. It's a much more important role than you might think, okay? They can put it on their LinkedIn even, and cool. Gives them a reason to work for it, and then if they don't do it, then you can say, hey, you were supposed to do this, right? Another nice tip here, make sure that by the entry or exit, which is often the same thing, obviously, is a piece of paper where people can leave like their email address, so you can add them to a mailing list or something, and you can contact them, the visitors I'm talking about. So this way you build up, you know, a contact list of people that you can tell about new meetings that you will have, about new events, or even ask for input, ideas for speakers, etc. Put an email subscription list at the entry. So once you have something going, assuming that all these tips helped you in some way, it's time to start trying to grow. You have regular meetings, there are a couple of people coming there, it is fun, you start to get to know each other, you know, go out for drinks every now and then. How do you get further? Now, first step is, of course, getting the word out, advertising a little bit. It's nice to have a website with info about the meetings. Keeping it really simple is just fine. You can also do it at a site like meetup.com. But in general, I would use a bunch of social media. So I would make sure that there's one place where people can find the authoritative information. And then you set up a Facebook event page and maybe even Twitter thingy, Google Plus event page, of course, and link it all to this, you know, one page. Don't make it too big. I mean, you need to be able to maintain it. Obviously, if you have a volunteer who loves building websites, which in our IT world is, of course, not unlikely, then cool, use it, let him or her do that. You know, then you have a director of, I don't know, websites. But otherwise, just keep it simple. And try to automate things a little bit. You know, you can spend massive amounts of time on Twitter and Facebook and Google Plus, but you can also connect them and just use one of them, right? That's what I personally do as well. It's not perfect, but it works. It is nice to have a mailing list or a forum, depending on your audience, where people can even talk about things and keep the community alive in the time that you don't have meetings, because obviously the online part is for a lot of us really important as well. Most of us feel completely lost without laptops, tablets, and internet. So having a place where you can have discussions is really good, especially if you try and do reports of all the meetings. I mean, it can be short, but something with, you know, a couple of pictures and a short report on what the speaker talked about, etc. If you manage to put that on your site, a simple WordPress install maybe, that gives people also an idea of the previous meetings, what it is about, what kind of subject you have. I mean, just a meetup and you have no idea where it's coming from is quite a different thing than going to a meetup where you know that has been going on for a year and where regularly people go to. So build up this history and maintain that is, you know, easy. And it's, again, something you can delegate to someone. Because when you grow, you really need to delegate things. That becomes more and more important. Another way to promote your events, your local community, is to go to local, you know, Linux user groups, local other events maybe, and hang up, you know, an A4 with some info about your meetups and your communities. I mean, people who go to one event are often the type of people who, surprise, go to events, so they might come to yours too. No reason not to promote a little bit in your local community that way. Once you start to grow, you might need a bigger venue. You might even need some money for coffee, tea, and cake. If you're interested in trying to find sponsors, try to find more than one. If you go for sponsors, get multiple sponsors. It's better to ask one sponsor once a year than to so that you have 12, for example. It's better to have yourself multiple sponsors that you each ask once a year than to have to go back to one sponsor again and again and again. Another thing is, don't be too shy and ask for too little money. Basically, for most companies, it is about as much work and effort and honestly pretty much cost to pay $150 or $500. So ask for $500 and then you're done. It's easier to ask 5 sponsors each once a year for money and then use that for 1 or 2 meetings than to try for each meeting get 3 sponsors. It's just a lot harder for companies to pay smaller amounts. Again, for especially for bigger companies, 1,000 or 250, it's the same. Really, they don't care about that. It's just extra work for them to do 250 4 times, so they won't. Yeah. Find local sponsors, local IT companies maybe. They might be interested simply because the audience that you get at your meetings might be interesting for them, right? Or they might be working on their reputation in the local tech community. You'd be surprised how often small local companies are quite okay paying a couple of hundred euros once a year to have their name you know, at these local tech meetings, especially, again, if it's technical. This is really valuable for them. I know it gets complicated when you have to handle money, so just let them pay the bill for something. Just get your catering to make a bill and let them pay that directly. It's much easier than having to handle cash, and it's often possible to do it that way. In the US, you can often use American Express gift checks. That actually makes handling the money a lot easier. Not an option in Europe, but in the US, this really works. Um, when you're looking for sponsors, ask the people who come to your meetups if they know a company. Maybe their employer is interested. They can very often help you find a local company who's willing to help sponsor something small. And obviously, you should reward the sponsors as well, right? I mean, put the logo on the webpage, mention them. You know, try and make sure that you measure the hits to your website so that the sponsor actually knows what they're paying for. If you get 5 or you get 500 visitors, makes a big difference for a sponsor when they want to put a banner on your website. Eh? So, and keep in contact with your sponsors. Even if they sponsor like once a year and you go to them once a year, make sure you have like a newsletter for your, you know, local meetups, and you send them the reports every month. You know, and make sure that they're mentioned in the report, you know, thanks to our sponsors. I mean, that way they get a feeling that they're actually getting something for their money. After all, they're companies, they need to make money, it needs to be worth it for them. You know? Be a little smart about that if you can. More growth tips. This is a really simple trick if you want to try and grow your community. Do something like a Bring a Friend program with small rewards. You know, so that is ask everybody who comes to bring someone they know and might be interested in the subject for next week, next month, etc. And then suddenly, well, you have twice as many people, and some of them might stick around. And, you know, if you do that twice a year and everybody who succeeds at bringing a friend gets something, you know, ask one of your sponsors for a pack of USB sticks. It's simple, these kind of things, but they really work. You get more people this way. One tip, this is something, you know, that came up at quite a few events. You notice in communities people love to do crazy things. And sometimes the people, you know, either in charge or companies around these communities, they don't really like that because it's weird, you know, or something crazy is happening with their brand, you know, like somebody is I don't know, making a graffiti of their Geeko, you know. Really, this is cool, support it, love it, make pictures of it, promote the heck out of it. This kind of creativity and enthusiasm, it's the sign of an, you know, effective, fun local community. So if you come up with a logo, please be really relaxed about it and let everybody tattoo it on their forehead or whatever they want. Okay, getting it out is good, creativity is good. It's team building, it's giving people a chance to do something funny. I mean, we have folded yourself geekos, we have cube geekos, we have all this stuff is awesome. Okay, promote it, let people do this. Now, when you're growing, you might get a little bigger. I mean, this is obviously only interesting when you have like 50 people there every month. You know, you can't be there every month. So you need to make sure that when you're not there, it's still running. So you need to find some minions, some people willing to do the work. Now, I use the term minions because in open source, there are always more minions than leaders. There are few people willing to start initiatives and put in the work to actually make them happen. There are also always plenty of people willing to talk. Eh? I mean, I'm not talking about talking. I'm talking about people who are willing to start something up and just get doing it instead of talking. And there are always a lot more people who are willing to actually help such a person, who are willing to put in some effort to support it and make it happen. Now, you need to find those people and help them, you know, tell them what to do and make them help you with the event. Give them responsibilities, like I already gave a couple of examples, somebody who welcomes people, somebody who takes care of the website, somebody who maybe talks to the sponsors, somebody who writes the reports, etc. These things are, you know, these are things you can quite easily hand over to other people. Obviously, when you do it, you really need to hand it over, right? You need to step back and trust them that they do a decent job. So it's okay if they ask, like, how should I do this? And then you say, well, for example, you can do X, Y, Z. But if they want to do something else, well, you should give responsibilities, not tasks. Try to give people a responsibility for something. And if they want to do it in a different way than you would have done it, you need to give them some freedom. Perfectionism and micromanagement are really things that don't work in the long run. So don't micromanage. Give something to someone else and let them run with it. That's going to mean, that means they're going to make mistakes. But that's part of learning, okay? People can't learn without making mistakes. So if you want other people to ever take over a task from you, You gotta accept that they will make mistakes and that it's gonna get screwed up once or twice. And you gotta live with that. Otherwise, well, if you really wanna do it all on your own, that's fine. But realize that it's gonna die the moment you stop and that it will never get big, because it can't get big if one person does the work. Yeah. So if you really care about it, you're gonna have to accept that other people need to learn and make mistakes. Now, of course, that doesn't mean you can't keep an eye on them, because people, well, they don't just make mistakes, but they also disappear sometimes or just don't do what they're supposed to do. That's not a thing. I mean, you can keep an eye on it, give feedback to people and ask them, are you really still doing this? Now, obviously, if someone can't do their, you know, job, the thing they're supposed to do once or twice, that's okay. But if they consistently fail, then at some point, yeah, you're going to have to find someone else to do it and hand it over. That's not cool. So you should really give people a chance to admit for themselves they can't do it and to step down. But yeah, there is a point where you have to do it yourself, and that's sometimes not cool. But don't do it because they make mistakes, because then they're still learning, okay? Do it if they really don't want to learn or they can't put in the time. Don't punish people for making mistakes, because that's just one of the biggest, I think, problems in our society in general, which I'm not trying to fix here, I'm just telling you. Don't punish people for mistakes. Punish them for not learning from them, because that's fair. Another thing is value all contributions, okay? It doesn't matter how small. If someone brought cake to a meeting, you know, make sure that you announce it and say, that person is awesome because they made cake, let's all eat it. And that's, of course, assuming the cake is nice too, but be happy in general. I mean, even if people just tweeted and retweeted the meeting, thank them for it. They're helping you promote it. It's valuable, right? You're reaching people outside of your group. Thank people for what they do, always. Give credit to other people. Don't always try to be in the spotlight yourself. If someone else helps you with something, give them some attention for that. I mean, that's cool. Credit where it is due, and even a little more credit than might totally be due is cool. Okay. It's important for community building. So, gather. Most communities have a small number of very active people that do stuff, right? It's always a lot of people join, a lot of people talk, a much smaller number of people actually does stuff. So these people deserve some extra attention. Okay, these are the people you go out with once a month for dinner together, just with that group that actually does the work. A little bit of exclusivity really isn't that bad. It's okay. Yeah, I mean, the Open SUSE conference only is also, you know, we give travel support only for the people that, well, do stuff, right? At least that's the idea behind things like this. And these are also people you can get feedback from. So at this dinner, you can discuss what you can improve, get ideas, you know, discuss what to do next, obviously, who can do what. Share with them what's going on. I mean, after all, they might now be minions, but in the future, they might be able to take over things from you, bigger things. And even if you, well, I don't know, move to another city and can't continue the meeting anymore, it's really nice if there's a successor who can actually take over. So share with them what's going on. Share what, why you do things, what the problems are. First of all, because they might help out. And second of all, that's how they learn what the work is and what needs to be done. I already mentioned the other things here. Okay. Yeah, and by the way, someone who steps down because they can't do something anymore, you know, that's not an embarrassing thing, right? We all have a real life. It's okay to not be able to do something. It happens to me 100 times that someone in the community promised to do something and they couldn't manage to do it. That's okay. Okay, we have real lives, and our family, you know, should really matter more than, you know, whether you updated the website online. I mean, we'll survive without that website. And, you know, if your boyfriend or girlfriend leaves you, that really is a much bigger deal. So, you know, be realistic about that, okay? People will not have time for everything, and make clear that that's okay. If they want to spend more time on their family, or if they want to do something else, cool. Okay, make sure that they don't feel locked into whatever, you know, they're supposed to be doing. doesn't mean you don't need to be reliable. If you can't do something in time, you should tell people. That's a different thing. But it's not an embarrassing thing. It's just, you know, it's normal. It's okay. It's good as a local community to also stay connected to the international community. So in case of OpenSUSE, make sure that, well, if you can't, at least someone on the team, you know, follows the international news and can actually tell you guys what's going on. If something is happening internationally, like the OpenSUSE conference, it's really cool to, the week or the month after the conference, do a meeting about the conference to, you know, discuss what happened, maybe have someone, you know, who went to the conference speak about the event, maybe play one or two of the talks, maybe the keynote. Every meeting you can have a 15-20 minute session, as I already mentioned, to discuss the international news, the gossip, you know, who is angry at who. I mean, you know, that is the stuff that keeps people, you know, excited and engaged. So stay connected, you know, and maybe every now and then you can invite people from the international community to come visit and to give a talk. You know, maybe even you can find a local sponsor to help with the travel support for someone from the international community, or we have a travel support program which is for this. If you have a local community and you would like to have somebody really cool come and give a talk, well, email the travel support program. Hey, you know, I'd like to have person X, Y, or Z come and visit my program, my local community, to give a talk. Can you help support that? Most communities have support for this, so use it for that. There's money for that. Okay. Another thing is, of course, stay in contact with the upstream community, so to say, actively from local to there. So send reports maybe every now and then. Use the materials that they use. OpenSUSE has a lot of materials actually for people for local events. We have ready-made presentations occasionally about new releases or about technologies we have that you can use for your local community. So use the materials that are available. Ask maybe for, I don't know, a package with some stickers and flyers and stuff every now and then. Use what you have basically and what we have locally. A slightly less positive thing perhaps, it's important to keep a healthy atmosphere in a community, and unfortunately this doesn't always go by itself. As I already said, you know, it's good to write down what your community is about and what it's doing. Well, while you're at it, a code of conduct is probably a good idea. The earlier you have this, the easier it is, because introducing a code of conduct in a community with 500 people can be tough, as I have experienced. It's a lot easier to have it at the beginning. And obviously, this is all obvious stuff, you know, an anti-harassment thing, you know, people should behave, not be rude with other people. I mean, this is obvious, but there are people who feel they can do or say anything, and then it can be necessary to deal with that. I have some tips about how to do a code of conduct, but honestly, I would suggest to look online, look at the code of conduct of a big community like OpenSUSE, and start from there. Copy that, just use that verbatim or with a few modifications, instead of making your own, because there is a bunch of mistakes you can make while making a code of conduct, including trying to make a list of all the things you can do wrong. That list is, first of all, endless, and second of all, very much up for debate, which means you can discuss it forever. So, you know, copy one online. Another thing is, if people behave badly, I gave some feedback tips in my talk about social skills for geeks. Use those. Talk to people in private, give them a warning maybe, give them a timeout, tell them, look, this really didn't work, you're not welcome next week or next meeting. And then let them come back after that. I mean, people, again, make mistakes, so give them time to learn. But at the same time, there are people who never learn, unfortunately. So be prepared to tell them they're never, ever welcome. That really can happen sometimes. I mean, a single person can really kill an entire community if you let them. So don't, okay? And if you get stuff like, I don't know, freedom of speech and that kind of nonsense, it's totally irrelevant here. X Cassidy has a beautiful comic about this. I should have included it here. But freedom of speech means that you can say whatever you want without the government locking you up. And you can say it outside in your own garden or your own website. Freedom of speech does not mean you're allowed to ruin other people's lives. Okay? And if people don't like you and close the door and don't want you at their meetings, that's not limiting freedom of your speech. It just means you're a dick and they don't like you. Yeah? So you are doing a meeting with a couple of other people. You're having fun. That's your place. If people don't behave there, that's their problem, and you have every right to deny them access to your meeting. Okay? So don't feel bad about that. Again, don't use this lightly. You certainly shouldn't. But don't let one person ruin it. Don't drag it out. Don't let one person come back again and again and again and ruin the atmosphere. Kick them off the mailing list. Kick them off the forum. Kick them out if it's necessary. I know, it's negative, but seriously, this happens, and it's not fun. I know some people like diagrams, so I made a diagram. That would be, you know, how to get started with community. Some resources. There's a lot of resources on the web on how to do local events, tips and other stuff. I'll put my slides online as well. Most of the things I have said is actually in the notes section of my slides. So if you think, you know, what is the use of all these, you know, funny, colorful pictures? Well, there is more information in my slides than, you know, you might think. So that's it for now. Any questions, feedback, ideas? What should I add to the presentation? Tell me.
Okay, supposing I don't have any idea what my... okay, I have the content ready, but supposing I don't know who will be interested in my session or something like that. So how do you actually get the people that you want? Like, how do you like find out like who can be interested in such an event?
Hello? Okay. Now, this is indeed the start-up issue, right? Let me try and go back to the beginning. So, how do you get people? Let me see. Yes. So, what, where, and how? Basically, this is the part why I said start small, because word of mouth is one of the best ways of promoting it. And trying to organize a 50-people meeting the first time you do a meeting is just crazy. Don't. Start with friends, co-workers, family, seriously, people you know. That's the easiest way. Of course, put it on your own Twitter account and Facebook and all that stuff. And try meetup.com. There are a couple of, including Meetup, but there are a couple of websites that actually help you with this. Just Google around a little bit and use those. And don't expect too much from the first meeting. You know, if 5-7 people show up, really, that's fine. Because the next time there might be 8 and then 10, and you know, before you know it, there are 50 people. And if they're done, if there are not, I mean, it's fine too, right? So, yeah, I mean, it is hard to reach the right people, but that's mostly a startup issue. Once you have a bit of something going on and it has a clear, you know, thing that it is about and a clear identity, that's also why I said, you know, you need to have a focus. The more you have an identity, the easier it is for people to recognize what your event is about and to come to it. So, yeah, combination of not too big ambitions and a clear focus is what solves the chicken egg problem, I think. Yeah. Any more questions? Well, that's it then. Thank you very much. And this is also pretty much the end of the conference. So, thank you.